everyone here remember 9/11? I'm talking about the actual event, not the holiday. I assume you all remember the holiday. That's why we're all gathered here today. All right, let's get something out of the way. This is not audience participation. Even when I ask you a question, it's usually rhetorical. We've got people coming up here. We're going to be performing. So y'all generally, unless you're laughing or giggling, shut the fuck up. Kind of general protocol for performance. Thank you. So time for the comedy. 9/11. Remember, the 9 stands for September. For the rest of the evening. When I say remember the Alamo, it's a rhetorical question. Most of you were not around back then. When people say remember the Alamo, it is not a question, it is a directive. And I want you all to remember that because it has nothing to do with the rest of my speech. All right, 9/11 was a recent event. Most of us here tonight were alive when it happened. We were making grown-up memories. I need to say this up front, though. I was not there. And I would not consider myself an expert or a scientist, but I still have some things to say. I want to talk about these so-called 9/11 truthers. You know what I'm talking about? You know these people?
Yeah.
Right, right. Now, these are people who doubt the official narrative of 9/11, who think that there is a massive conspiracy with the government and the media and various shadowy organizations. Again, I was not there. Here is the official narrative, as we, most of us, understand it. On Tuesday morning, September 11th, an airplane, flew into one of the World Trade Center buildings, of which there were 2. Then, right after, another plane, also an airplane, flew into the other World Trade Center building. Then, both of the buildings fell down. Again, I was not there.
Seems fishy.
Okay. There is a definite value to skepticism, but I would like to address a few truther arguments. Now, if any of you here in the audience consider yourselves truthers, I ask you to please keep an open mind. But maybe the other way that you're not used to, where you're down with believing something that everybody else believes. Okay, first let's talk about the actual towers themselves.
Like jet fuel.
All right, shut the fuck up! God damn it, do you remember like 3 minutes ago when I was like, don't shout out random shit? Sorry, I'm looking right at you. I don't know if you said something, but all right. Anyway, shut up! The actual towers themselves. All right, my God.
You're sweaty Redditor. You're sweaty.
Yeah, shut the fuck up.
You just, that's gibberish, my God. All right. Let's get that one because I yelled a bit. If 9/11 is some massive hoax, where are the towers? All right. Where are they hiding them? And again, this guy knows. I was not there. But you can go to New York City, and you can look around, and there are no World Trade Centers anywhere. I haven't been since, either. I know that hurts my case. But there is a lot of circumstantial evidence. But let's, for the benefit of the doubt, let's say the truthers are right. Let's examine these points. Common argument, if the towers did not fall, they were either moved to a secret location or they were rendered invisible by magic. A lot of y'all are familiar with this one. No, this is ludicrous. We all know the only sorcerer powerful enough to do something like that in New York City, which has very strict regulations. There's only one sorcerer, and that's David Copperfield, who once did something very similar to Lady Liberty. I'm sorry, ma'am. This is all very soon. That's a reference for older folks. But David Copperfield has been dead a very long time. And people use that as a plus in their argument. They say, well, he died 100 years ago to the day before September 11th. He was killed by a team of New York City police and firemen, and with his dying breath, he swore, quote, fantastical, magical revenge against the entire city. This is circumstantial at best. Some people say the towers were dismantled piece by piece and thrown into the Hudson River. That's preposterous. Even putting the issue of union labor aside, even with dozens of people, this would take hours. Curiously, the most common argument these days is that holograms were used to fake the entire thing. I think a lot of this comes from the fact that they use holograms every year on 9/11 to reenact the events. Holograms are a very popular and respectful way to pay tribute to the dead. I actually hear this morning, it was a great tribute. They had Bon Jovi playing. It was real cool. Next year it's going to be DMX and the Bon Jovi hologram. It's worth the trip. I've never been. I just hear it's really cool. Anyway, people forget holograms have not been around that long. Perry Farrell invented them in 2008, and they didn't achieve 3D until the next year. It's ridiculous. Even putting that aside, there are plenty of other angles that these truthers take. We've all heard this one. Planes can't fly that high. What do you even say to that? I mean, I don't know how high planes can fly. I've never been on one. I'm not a scientist. Nobody knows how high planes can fly. I mean, this is something scientists have been arguing about for a long time. It's never going to be settled to anyone's satisfaction. It's wasting our time just to even bring it up. All right, I have some images to show you guys, and these are going to be really hard for some of y'all to see, and I apologize, especially some of y'all in the back. I have an old iPhone. My screen's really bad. As you can see, this is a picture of the World Trade Center Memorial. Clear as day. Now, there are a lot of questions about this, but I promise you, it's not a hologram. It's a real building. Controversial, maybe, but videos exist of people throwing things at this real building. Balls, pennies, other coins, and in one instance, a paper airplane, which I thought was very, very poor taste. The monument is also not a hologram generator. I really don't know what that thing is. There's a big crazy spire on top. It's kind of goofy looking. We should move on. All right, I'd like to close with one final point of order. On 9/11, remember September 2001, at 8:56 a.m., the International NTR-8 ABBR was listed at 7.6. There are people out there who will tell you that that number was 7.3. And if you listen to them long enough, their arguments make sense. 7.3. Fewer. 7.6, it's complicated. Say 7.3, you take the 7, you add it to the 3, you get 10. You take the 0 away, it's 1. Clean, easy, done. And life's not that simple. Life is not that clean and easy. You look at the... If you go back and you... Look. 9/11 happened.
Something happened.
Thank you. Our government probably had something to do with it. I don't know. Just maybe, I don't know. But anyway, let's get on with the show! Woo! Coming up next, an empty stage!
Psycho Satan presents Good Evening with Connor and Billy.
So you guys are a duo. We're a duo.
You're a way better Connor than Connor. No?
It was a bit. You're at a comedy show.
What did you do, Connor?
What was it like being able to choose from someone other than Connor?
Someone who just like really just runs things into the ground. Did anyone out there have like a quit your job fantasy?
Be like, fuck you, Connor, I quit!
I am the pizza pope.
Amen! Every time someone cool comes on, you get jealous.
Your prognosis is, you still love each other.
You don't know what you're talking about. Billy and I are in love.
Yeah, I didn't know you could get a psychology degree from fucking clown college.
So if I have a car and a love for pizza?
A belief for pizza.
I didn't kill my wife.
I don't care.
All this talk of quitting jobs.
I got a lot of deliveries tonight before the pizza pope shifts.
I got more questions.
Billy.
Fuck you, Connor! I quit!
Yeah. 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 Delivery time!
Fuck off!
Could this be the end of Good Evening?
So long, I got to do your show once, and now look at me, I'm on stage. This is fucking great. Mm-hmm. This is cool. I guess you do a monologue right now or so. That's what it says on the sheet.
We kind of stopped doing that after the first one. It was really corny and hacky, and we just don't want to do it anymore. But you know.
Okay, I'm not going to mark you for that. I'm definitely going to make a note. I don't think corporate knows about that.
You don't need to do
monologue.
It just wasn't working for the show. People who were here the first time, they understand it was really corny and I'm really bad at it, so we just cut it. You'll learn.
Connor, are you gonna pay for the pizza or not?
I didn't order.
Jesus Christ, it's my last delivery of the night. I either get paid for the pizza or I don't have enough gas to get home, you asshole. Are you just trying to embarrass me? Oh, Billy's a pizza driver now. I was gonna get him out of here while we get Ned, the fucking scab on the show!
Hey! You quit!
Hey!
You quit the show! You quit! You quit on me!
You made me sleep in the cage!
That was in your contract, you knew about this!
I fucking hate this pizza stew and I hate you!
Come on, I have to write you up for that. That's littering on the
You stage. Can't write him up, he quit the show. Billy,
just pay me for the pizza!
Billy, well, after we get paid out from the
Why don't you just stay?
I've been here the whole time!
Why don't you stay in the
Everyone's seen me! You've all seen me! I'm on the clock! Is this what you do to a working American?
Billy,
hey, you got on the show free. Why don't you stay for the show?
Shut the fuck up, you scab!
Why don't, Billy, look. We'll let you in for free. Please watch the show. We'll pay you as soon as the show's over, okay?
I'm gonna take a piss. God damn it.
If it's your butt.
Okay.
Fuck! God, shut up!
Please, let me thank you. Jesus. Awkward, right? Really awkward.
Fuck off. Look, let's just go ahead and skip to our first guest. We have a guy who apparently he works at LucasArts or something. I don't really know.
No, I'm just your cameraman.
Oh, okay. Well, let's bring on our cameraman, Grant Carr, everyone. So, good to see to you, Grant.
Yeah. So I'm just glad to be here. You know, I don't know if anyone here is a Star Wars fan.
I was raised on this stuff.
So last Friday was Force Friday, you know, and now today is 9/11. 9/11 is the official start of the holiday shopping season. So like, they got started last week just to really kick it off with like, you know what Force Friday is?
Yes, I do.
Huge blitz of marketing, merchandising, like all the new products for the new movie came out. At midnight last Friday,
yeah.
My wife and I were up there at midnight at Target getting all our shit. A lot of cool stuff like Target, Toys R Us, even Bed Bath & Beyond is getting in on it. Then, like, everyone had like new exclusive products. But the thing is, I think we got next slide here. So if you're in the front row here, you can see. That's not me. It's just some random. It's a Google image search of some people like digging for stuff online.
That's making it smaller. You're a bad co-host.
Okay. I haven't been trained on this. I'm sorry. I just co-host.
You're supposed to make it bigger, dipshit.
I just co-host.
So it's just, you know, some people going there and. I apologize for having to read notes, but it's just so fucking hot in here. So we got Force Friday, and some of the products out of the thousands that were like launched, you know, not every company was able to get the Star Wars license, which is very sought after, as you can imagine. It's just like printing money, basically. So some of them got rejected. So this segment is what I like to call rejected Star Wars products, and
that's fun.
Yeah. So the first one we have up is Subway, and you know, Subway, you know, with Jared, they've had some embarrassing things, you know. So I thought it was interesting. Let's go ahead and go to the next slide. I thought, you know, after having one vile, disgusting criminal as their spokesperson, I thought it was a weird choice to go with Jabba the Hutt on it, but. So that didn't make the cut.
Right, understandably.
but oddly enough, the reason it was rejected had nothing to do with the Jared Fogle child molestation. It's just Disney has a very strict policy against not supporting companies that sell disgusting sandwiches. So Subway did not get picked up, but you know, there's another one. Let's go to the next slide here. We have some Jakku kitty litter. If you're not familiar, Jakku is the new desert planet that's pretty prominently featured in the new in the previews. So that's just some sand. I think it's pretty obvious why this shitty idea didn't get picked up. Sorry for the pun. All right. So. You know, these next few products are targeted more towards women. I think it's LucasArts. They're really trying to reach out to that female fan base that are getting more into like geek culture and sci-fi and things like that. So these next couple slides are some healthcare products for women. So here is. Lightsaber applicators. As you can see, there's a lot of different force handles.
It's biodegradable!
It may not be biodegradable, but the thing is, like, collectible, I don't understand how collecting it works. It seems a little gross to me. But, you know, maybe it's just because I'm a guy. Alright, so let's go and go to the next one. Our next one is, This is a birth control morning after pill that is shaped like the Death Star. It's like a million, you know, it's like a million sperms, you know, cried out in frustration. They were suddenly unable to fertilize an egg. Like that, they were silenced.
And why did this not go over well?
It's hung up in test trials with the FDA. But they're hoping it'll at least be ready for launch for the next movie. So we've got one more.
We'll see here. This is a clear blue. They made a home pregnancy test. This one, it will detect the metachloridian levels of your fetus. I like the count. Is my child the chosen one the prophecy speaks about, the one who will bring balance to the force? Well, with the new clear blue easy, you can test out if your child is. So, honestly, I don't know why that one didn't get picked up. I feel like that'd be pretty cool.
The Jedi. Yeah.
The midichlorians aren't real, but yeah.
It's a thing.
Are they still canon?
It is canon. It is canon. So, so let's move along. I really don't have time to get into the metachloridian argument. It's very polarizing. All right. So next up is a.
I'm gonna
have
to write that.
Yeah, we have Jar Jar Kinks is a whole line of sex toys, Star Wars themed. This is supposed to be available in select adult stores and select online retailers, but it just didn't work out. But you know, as Jar Jar Binks would say, "Mama, me so horny." It gets better / worse. So, you know, with this product, R2-D2, you better watch out. There's a new droid in town, and he's got some products. I'm sorry, that's an actual real product. That's a real product. Let's go to the next slide. Next slide, please. There we go. We got the BB-8 butt plug.
I'm sorry, I have to ask you. Is that Sasha Gray?
It is.
That was really funny, Chode Host!
Trying to do my job.
Your job sucks. That's why I quit.
Did I blur it out enough? Is that okay?
That's fine.
I really just wanted to leave this one on screen as long as possible. All right, so we've got that one. And you know, the next one, this anal play is not for everyone, but about half of us here have a penis, so this next product should relate. Fleshlight made a name for themselves. So here we have. Starlight Pit Fleshlight Saber. As you can see, this is a really nice product. It's a cast aluminum, so it should last a long time. You should be able to hand that down to your kids once they're old enough. I know it looks gross, but this is made of the same silicone as the other fleshlights, so. That's about it. I really feel like Lucas, you know, filmed and Disney, they're just leaving so much money on the table with these products. Do you think that they would put them out there?
I don't think that. I completely understand why none of these products got picked.
You're telling me that you wouldn't buy one of that?
No! No, it looks horrifying. It would shred me. No, you can go back to the camera. I really appreciate it.
What the fuck, Ned? You didn't even stick up for Grant!
Who's being lewd on the show? That's against. Don't talk to me right now. We're doing the show.
Thank you, Billy.
Okay, we're done with first guest interview, so you do jokes now, right? You do jokes now. That's what's on the layout.
Yeah, sometimes we do. We do.
Okay, so tell me, it's more fun.
You kind of put me on the spot. I can't. That's not really. Have you ever watched the show?
Yeah, I've been on stage here before, and I see how you guys do it, and I'm just trying to help you out. I mean, corporate gives us this perfect list. They know how a show works. They're corporate, dude.
Well, see, when
is that planner as tight as your asshole?
Fuck you. One strike.
When Billy hosted the show.
Don't say my name.
When he hosted the show.
Can we please just stop talking? Can we just pretend he's.
When he hosted the show, we just had more of a chemistry. Like, we had known each other for so long. It's a lot easier to riff.
I'm friendly.
Yeah, okay.
We can be friends.
We can be coworkers.
Shake hands with the devil, Connor!
Okay, well, let's. Do you want to riff? Okay. Super Griffin gift. Okay. So I was given a list of riff topics.
This one's fun.
If you could eat with any famous person, dead or alive, and I don't mean a corpse. Okay? I'm talking like they're in there, they're flesh and blood, they're alive, they're in their prime even. Who would it be?
I don't know, man. Bernie Getz.
Who's Bernie Getz?
Well, he shot some people in the... It doesn't matter.
That is dark. They warned me about dark. They said that would happen on the show. Wow.
Okay. What about you?
Oh, Albert Einstein, maybe? Jesus, I don't know. I'm not much of a ripper.
Corporate gave me some jokes. Do you want me to just tell a joke? Keep the crowd moving, you know what I mean?
Okay.
All right, cool. Okay. Is it cool if I stand up while I do this one?
Go for it.
Sick. Okay, cool. Do you think anyone's ever told an astronomer, hey, don't quit your day job?
Thank you, Chris. Thank you.
What was that? Two strikes. Yeah, how's that? Is that funny?
That joke was worse than my grandpa's funeral.
Don't egg him on, dude. We have to do the show. Don't egg him on. Do you want me to tell another joke?
Sure.
Okay, cool, awesome. So the invisible man walks into a doctor's office, and he walks up to the nurse, and the nurse is like, I'm sorry, the doctor can't see you right now. And the invisible man's like, yeah, that's the problem.
Yeah!
That's funny. Those are funny. They're funny. Come on.
Okay. Yeah, that was great. The audience clearly loved you.
Yeah, jokes.
Yeah, you're really killing it on your first day.
Jeez. I'm erasing some of these problems.
So you got anything else?
Oh, another joke?
You have one?
I mean, don't you want to do jokes? Okay, I love this show. I love it already. Okay, do you think... This one's a tricky one. Do you think that the place where Stephanie Meyer writes her books, she calls it the Twilight Zone? That's a good joke. By corporate, I'm the company.
Yeah, and we can tell.
You quit, okay, buddy? You quit. This is my job. That's my notebook. That's my notebook. My pen. Get out! Yeah, you're fucking fired. All right, I'll fucking get out. But you know what? Fuck you and fuck this fucking show. You guys all fucking suck. This show's for fucking pansies, okay? Get out! So far, let's get this fucking show started.
been practicing. That's a new song.
No, yeah, practice.
Yeah.
So what's going on with you guys? Are you? Cause that sounded like Bruce Springsteen.
Who's the boss? Is blowing up, like really making money. Hey,
Drummond coming out there?
That's me.
Holy shit! Hey. You've been served.
I didn't know we had like ASCAP people come to our show.
We've been serving a cease and desist order from Tony Danza. We can't do our tribute band, Who's the Boss, anymore, apparently.
Well, you know, you can always play on our show. It's not like we're taping it or anything. Nobody will see it on YouTube.
You know, we'll take Tony Danza off next month. He's off. This is crossing the line.
That'd be pretty awkward. So let's get this show properly started. Woo! I can't tell you how glad I am to have Billy back on.
It's good to be back, dude.
We're gonna do Boys Are Back in Town.
Boys are back in town.
Yeah! Boys! All right, yes. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get everything started. Give it up for your first guest. She's a poet, Miss Sarah Kraft. How long did it take you to put that together?
It was a quick trip to the store.
So you bought it?
Yeah.
It's like the underwater city people.
Correct.
Atlantis.
Yeah. So, what did you think of that fucking clone?
He looked like he might have been even hotter than I am right now.
It's very, very hot in here. There's a lot of people.
So, hey, you can all rip your shirts if you feel like you rip your shirt.
Don't do that. So we brought you on here because I don't know how many people out there know this about Sarah, but she writes poetry inspired from news headlines. And I've read some pretty funny shit on your Tumblr.
Yeah, it is Tumblr.
I didn't know if it was worth pressing. So, one of the things you've been doing lately is you're just covering all the presidential candidates, and there are quite a few of them.
Yes.
And they're all great. My favorite one was the one you wrote about Ted Cruz cooking bacon with a gun.
Yeah. I didn't know there was one in here, but yeah, I was really inspired by the video that he put together of cooking bacon on machine gun.
Did anyone see that video of him doing that?
I did not see it. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, it was so creepy and weird.
Oh, but he was trying to be so cool.
He wasn't pulling it off.
There was that dude on Twitter who kept on saying everyone would donate money once Ted Cruz blocked him.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah. He raised a shitload of money for Planned Parenthood. As a way of like, hey, until Ted Cruz's Twitter blocks me, I'm just going to keep donating all this money. And then a lot of people joined in, and he raised a lot of money. I don't know the exact amount, because I don't think he's blocked him yet, because he doesn't know how to use social media. So, why poetry? Why do you decide to do this?
I was obsessed with pop songs from a very young age. I wasn't allowed to listen to music at all because I was raised,
it's like
raised in the Southern Baptist home. Yes.
Wow.
So I started sneaking pop songs in my bedroom, like in the seventh grade.
I love the image of like someone like, I'm gonna sneak home like Judas Priest. It's like, no, I got this Wham album. Like, yeah, wake me up before you go.
So good.
It was all I knew. So anyway, I loved Janet Jackson and Paula Abdul and stuff. And so I started writing songs at my little desk.
Okay.
And they were terrible. And I was obsessed with trying to be a songwriter for a long time. And then just recently, I just started writing poetry. I have a creative writing degree too, so it's not out of nowhere.
Now, specifically, why are you doing poetry about news headlines?
I was a journalist for many years. I worked at the Houston Chronicle, and I was the overnight copy editor, so I would like pull, I was reading AP headlines all the time. And I still, I'm a social media manager for a company, so I'm just watching headlines all the time. So I have an emotional response to every single headline I read, so I'm like, oh, this is the one every, this day I'm gonna write about this. It's always something that inspires me.
And presidential candidates do that?
Well, they're horrifying.
Yes. Do you see Rick Perry with the first one
he
to bow
quit.
Out today?
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
if this is truly the worst number.
He just shot one coyote too many. He just jogs way too much.
So
if you get that reference.
I
not you, I'm talking to them.
Yeah. Perry shot a coyote one.
Yeah, welcome back, Billy.
You're better than that. You're already coyote. Right. Yeah.
In such hands.
No. Oh.
Kiss.
Well, oh, I thought you said piss and then I did.
Kiss.
Kiss.
No. This is really embarrassing.
Yeah, wait, look. She's on stage. We need to focus on Sarah right now.
Sarah.
Which is a good way to transition into, I know you brought some poems.
Yes, I'm poems. Going to read some poems. I'm going to start with some found poems. So every time a presidential candidate would announce, I would go home that day and go through all of the think pieces that were written and just create poems out of what everyone was writing. So, first one is Ted Cruz. Ted Cruz failed to mention that his wife worked for Goldman Sachs. He supports a giveaway to the rich, that white whale, the flat tax. He has yet to offer a single policy proposal or lifeline to the middle. His rhetorical style, frankly, makes my hair curl a little. He's selectively using one type of data over others. The man is wearing cowboy boots and formal clam diggers. They don't want their nominee to be a gun-toting Baptist Bible clinger. You have to have done something, said Charles Krauthammer.
Yeah! Now we clap. We gotta pick it up.
Yeah.
Rand Paul. Rand Paul entered and left to the song Shutting Detroit Down, in chants of President Paul from the packed crowd. He occupies space that no one is trying to fight for. He adheres to the criminal justice mindset that conservatives abhor. He opposes a one-size-fits-all approach to education. He's selling flip-flops and $1,000 signed constitutions. For the life of me, I can't figure out what he really believes. He's joining a burgeoning roster of totally pointless candidacies.
Yeah!
Woo! Woo! All right, Hillary Clinton. 8 years ago. 8 years ago, her weaknesses were clear. She's been running in place for the better part of 2 years. Reporters spent the day in limbo waiting for news to break. To become more authentic, Hillary must become more fake. Clinton could be called Michael Dukakis if she was not so willing to fight. She is earning endorsements from the left, center, and right. Her long career will challenge her to find ways to be new. Is her logo a naked appeal to Tinder addicted youth?
That got real!
Okay. Mike Huckabee, our favorite.
Yeah.
His manner and appearance are reassuringly ordinary, but he's one part of the 1%. He joked about $1 million and crossed a boundary, as did his son in a dog torturing incident. Look that up if you have not seen that. The Duggars sure love him. They think he's quite wise. He sometimes makes claims that are really just lies. And he's bad at theology, believes gays shouldn't be parents because children aren't puppies, and judges who think otherwise should be impeached. And gays are like alcoholics, and that's where I stopped because I couldn't keep reading this. Okay. This is an original poem about Donald Trump.
Yeah!
It's called, I Love Traditional Marriage So Much That I Keep Having Them. The story that day was a CNN host had asked Donald Trump what was traditional about having been married 3 times, and he said, I know, I blame myself. My business was just so powerful to me, and I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. But what would you say to a lesbian or gay man who's married, Tapper asked. I wouldn't say anything, Trump said. I'm just for traditional marriage. My first traditional marriage was with a lovely woman, the kind who bears the children you'll remember. You know the type. Socialite, severely blonde, ready to be rich.
My second traditional marriage was with my mistress. A real hot number, slick and perfumed, lights up a spa. You know the type, socialite, a natural blonde, ready to be hitched. My third traditional marriage was with a model, wears bandage-sized underpants, tan as the day is long. You know the type, socialite, hairless, ready to be ditched. Here's another thing. Another one about Donald Trump because he's just so inspirational to me. This is called Trumpy and the Nuge, and it is about Ted Nugent defended Donald Trump's lewd comments about Megyn Kelly when he said that she was on her period during the Republican debate. By making his own lewd comments, Nugent said, "I'm a big fan of Donald Trump because I believe in bold, aggressive, unapologetic truth, period. And I'm not a fan of Megyn Kelly. Although I often turn on Fox just to look at her. Sometimes when I'm loading my gun magazines, I like to just look at her, and I usually sit naked on the couch dropping hot brass on my stuff." Don't know what that means. So this is Trumpy in the Nuge. Out in the desert, a legged megaphone stumbles over brush. "Listen as I tell you the story of me. To nobody, to nothing, to passing tumbleweeds. You are not serious, and you have a rat's face. What are you doing? Just yelling and yelling, now cartwheeling and yelling, until a wet-eyed blizzard says, 'You are right,' and runs fast beside. Women are parts, and I have some parts, and I have some guns, and that's all we need." And they yelled and yelled and agreed and zigzagged the desolate drifts. Finally. Found poem of phrases from the Republican candidates' websites, as loud as possible. "Do you have a minute? I have a vision for a different America. Some say the American dream is over. We're currently in fourth place. Dangerous, unelectable, little political direction. It must be stopped before it's too late. This starts with you. Anybody with nothing can achieve anything. A plan to defeat the Washington machine. We need proven leadership. Let's get to work taking on the tough issues. We have to fall in love with America again. Take back America. Unleash our pride. We must once again become a nation of limitless possibility."
What are the Bernie Sanders poems?
Pony Sanders?
Yay. Pony Sanders!
You call him Pony Sanders?
He's from Berman!
So, yeah, do you do any third party candidates?
I haven't.
Or do you get picked to an easy target?
It just depends on the story. Like, you know, if Bernie Sanders.
They don't get media attention.
No. Oh, Lawrence Lessig retweeted me, so. I'm in touch with him.
Who?
Lawrence Lessig? Yeah.
Oh, wait, he's the Harvard professor.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, have you guys heard about him? Yeah. Who has not heard about him? All right, so he's a Harvard professor running for president, and he promises he will bring about election finance reform. He only had three things.
Oh, and then he's gonna quit, right?
Yeah, he's gonna quit.
Like, he's gonna do like just badass shit.
And then quit.
And then just like Clint Eastwood in the Spaghetti Western trilogy.
My vice president will either be John Stewart, which he won't do it. Or, Sanderberg, Sheryl Sanderberg from Facebook, whose husband recently died on a treadmill.
Yeah. So she needs to.
Well, Sarah, thank you very much for coming out of the show. We invite you to stay on with us. Yeah, give it up for Sarah Kress. Yeah. Sorry, 1 second.
My website is breakingpoems.com.
Give it up for Sarah! We're having a really good evening. That's the name of the show. So
I'll bring on our next guest.
Actually, mind if I have some time real quick?
Yeah, you need to, we're bringing on our next guest.
Right. Yeah, you remember me, Ned? How's it going, everybody?
You know what? I don't really need to see this. Fuck you.
Hey, oh, jeez, wow.
Don't leave me alone.
This is isn't about the show anymore, okay? I've moved on from that.
You can't. Can we? Can someone get him?
Don't worry about it, okay? Look, I found that my charisma would be better for America. You know what I mean? Guys, I'm running for the President of the United States. Let me speak for a moment. Let me be heard. Now, I've been on campaign tour since I left this show, and I've learned so much about this. Now, guys, before I start, let me tell you, I'm a person just like you. Yeah, I'm just like, I'm regular old plain Jane Joe lunchbox, okay? I go to work every day. I make 24 to 30K a year. I grew up in the South with my family, my mom, my dad, my 1.86 siblings, you know? I'm just like you, and I know what you need. I know what you need as a country, okay? And I'm a comedian, you know? Who better to lift the veil off of America? I play characters so I can wear hats, okay? Like Teddy R once said, laugh softly and carry a big shtick.
Oh.
Sit up here and I could gabber about policies and what we should do about what, but it's a democracy here. It's all about the people. So raise your hands, give me an issue, and I'll tell you how we can solve it, okay? Get right here.
What's your stance on the recent deal with Iran? Are you pro-sanction, or are you more for a clumsy type of approach to the whole U.S.-Iran?
That is such a pointed question.
Well, he asked.
Are you on or against?
All my candidates fucking
now, hold on.
You're Trump.
Hold on. What we do here to make things right, to make a deal correct, we make a MySpace for America. We add them to our top 8. That way, we're on good terms with them, but we can still talk shit behind their backs. It's a perfect strategy. You, over here.
What do you think about them gays getting married?
The gays getting married. Now, I am all about traditional values. Progressive traditional values, I might add. I think anybody can kiss whoever they want to kiss. Anybody can marry whoever they want to marry. And if you don't want to look at it, well, hell, I'll give you American flag blindfolds to cover it up.
Since you come to show audience member, I'm wondering, when are you going to bring back good Nickelodeon cartoon programming?
This is something I've been very much wanting to be talking about. Now, entertainment is a weird thing in America. Entertainment has changed so much, and cartoons are fantastic. But when it comes down to it, I want to reform entertainment altogether. I want to remove ninny, weenie talk show hosts that lick farts and suck butts like Connor and Billy, okay?
I have a question! Who the fuck are you?
Yeah. I'm future President Ned Gayle. Guys, I'm done here.
Okay,
but
get fired! You stand outside for 20 minutes, you come with some bullshit.
I was on campaign tour. I was grassroots.
American I hold that's gonna solve the problems of homophobia and unacceptance of different cultures in this country?
You're using
blindfolds?
Such large words that several people in the audience will know. I mean, 58.5% of these people only graduated with a high school diploma, okay?
Hey, now!
It's in the census, and once you know the numbers, you got the answers, baby. Okay? That's all
you know what? You're gonna win. You're gonna win.
Thank
it's
you.
Fine.
Thank you so much. I believe in you. Thank you so much. Guys, I only have one more thing to say. I love this country!
Marshall.
our last guest of the night. We have a little treat for you guys. We did some research, we made some calls, and we actually got a USO performer tonight. Yeah! Yeah, she's been all over the world, going out, supporting the troops. Hey, if you don't support the mission, we support the troops.
Great!
So, give it up for Kelly Juno, everyone! Very much for coming on to the show.
Yeah, of course, for you.
Stop. So, now, I said you're a USO performer, but specifically, what type of performance do you do?
I specialize in all sorts of things for crowds, dancing, singing, shaking, inspired monologues.
Ooh,
I could do all of those things. However, I am retired.
Okay.
I'm making a special thing for you tonight to come back and do my act. It's just, you know, USO performers don't get enough credit. You know, I still went overseas. I saw some very, very dark things.
Oh.
And sometimes I just feel like I'm back there, you know?
I'm sorry to hear that. What are you going to be doing for everyone here today?
If I may, I take the stage.
Do we need to move anything? Are you good?
I can work around it.
All right, sounds great.
Hi! Thank you so much for being here, guys. One of the reasons I agreed to do this today is because we have a very special guest in the audience. He, trust me, you know his story. It's been all over the news. One of the bravest Houston-based soldiers. You know his story already. Let me just introduce him. Matthew, please stand up.
Matthew! He is more than I do, buddy. Sorry. He's trained. He
Matthew.
Can handle it.
That's
Matthew,
the spirit.
You gotta say thank you for serving our country.
Yes.
Thank you.
For one person who's seen many, many dark things overseas, maybe more than you. I salute you.
Yeah, thanks.
Come on, guys! Every night while I'm undressing, saying my prayers and lightly confessing, I can hear hot licks from a set of drums upstairs. Well, it couldn't be Johnny, because he isn't there. Johnny's overseas, we know not where, but believe it or not, every night on the dot, I can hear a tenor drum say, woo!
Are you okay?
I'm okay.
Oh my god.
Can I try again?
Yeah!
Thank you. Yeah. Stand, you guys. How? Yeah.
You got it there, okay? This is my show, you son of a bitch!
Sit down.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Thank you, Kevin,
thank you for coming up to the show. Give it up for Kevin Tito.
Well, that was a little odd. If we could, music, please. Oh. How?
I was feeling it, and then I realized they're both liars.
They're not
like I tried to be his friend and he wouldn't even touch me.
Alright guys, thank you all so much for coming to the 9/11 show. A week. So we did our first show together and Jeremy said you're booked for the rest of the year. So I thought about going through the dates, finding out when our shows were. Lo and behold, 9/11 was one of our shows. And if you know me at all, you know that this is a fucking dream come true. I can't tell you how happy I am to not only have done a comedy show on 9/11 that is about 9/11 and very patriotically themed, but look at this fucking crowd. Could we turn the music up? It's just something.
Yes.